Good morning, church. How's everybody? It's good to have you with us this morning. God's Word, Psalm 106. The first three words are pretty important. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
You want to praise Him this morning?
Yes.
Well, let me read the rest of that verse. Give thanks to the Lord. Why? Because He's good. His love endures forever. Did you know that He loves you and there's nothing you can do that will change that? Because His love endures forever and He is good. So we come this morning to worship that God that loves us. Are you ready to do that? Is this on? You out there? All right, let's ask, hi. That wasn't planned, but that's... So we also want to invite our at-home worshipers to worship with us. Let's pray. Father, You are so good, and Your love does endure forever. And Father, you don't love us because we're good. You just love us because You're God. As we learn about that love more deeply today, God, would You send Your Spirit into this place? Would You stir our hearts? Would You surprise us with what you can do in us? We lift high the name that is above every name, Jesus. Amen. Let's pray. Let's worship together.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? Well, there's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? Well, there's wonderful power in the blood. It is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. It is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? Well, there's power.
Here because of what Jesus Christ has done for us in the power in the blood of Christ. God loves you, God loves me, and we are creations of His goodness and His grace. So this morning, God has made a way for you to be restored to the presence of God because of Jesus Christ. So we want to come together as the church this morning, and we want to lift high the name of Jesus, and we want to tell Him thank you for what He has done for us. And more than that, I hope you know the fellowship of the Holy Spirit of God this morning in your life, that He wants to be with you in this moment as we gather together as the church, in every moment. He made you a temple of the living God. He wants to dwell inside your heart, and that you may feel the presence of a holy and loving God deep inside of you, and know that God loves you. Let's continue to sing about this great God that we serve. let's give our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ a round of applause this morning. All right, children, y'all come on forward for your children's message. The rest of you may be seated.
Good to see everybody this morning. Are y'all excited to be here today? All right. Well, good. I am so excited that you're here. I'm so excited that we've come today to celebrate and learn about who? Jesus. That's right. So, I have a couple of pictures with me. All right. Y'all ready for my first one? What's it a picture of?
A monkey.
All right. What do you think my next picture is? A monkey. Do y'all like monkeys?
Yes.
Yes? Well,
I don't like them very much because they sometimes grow.
They do. Yeah, so I like monkeys when I go to the zoo, okay? Yeah. I don't want to be around a monkey too much. That's right. Monkeys are fun to watch, right? They hang in the trees, they swing from branch to branch, they do lots of fun things, they eat bananas, they throw coconuts, right? But there is one thing that monkeys do is they imitate or copy what others are doing. Did you know that? So if you do something, guess what the monkey's going to do? They're going to copy you. Or they're going to copy each other, you know? They imitate each other. So, yes. Do what?
Would a monkey copy you?
Maybe. I don't know. So my question is, do we want to learn from a monkey?
No,
that's right. But do you know someone that we should imitate? Jax? God, that's right. So we should imitate God, right? Or the Holy Spirit, that's right, you know. And it says in Ephesians 5, 1 and 2, it says, be imitators of God. Therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us. So we need to copy what God tells us to do, right? Right? And what he shows us to do. So, how do we find out what God wants us to do? We pray. What else? We read the Bible. Yes? That's right. Yes. What else do we do? Anything else? But everything that we know that God wants us to imitate is in his word, right? So if we read the word, can we know what God wants us to do?
Yes.
But if we don't read the word, can we know what God wants us to do? No, we need to read God's word. So God wants us to do lots of things and obey him and be imitators of him. So this morning, I've asked several kids to come up. Y'all stand up. Okay? And not y'all. These five kids. Sorry. I've got five right here. Come stand right here. They're going to read some scripture of things that we need to imitate so that we can follow God. Okay? Ready?
John 3:13-34. A new command I give you, love one another.
Ephesians 4:32, be kind and compassionate to one another.
Philippians 1:4, in all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy.
Ephesians 6:1, children, obey your parents.
Mark 16:15. Go and preach the good news of Jesus to everyone in the world.
Thank y'all. So those are some of the things that God's called us to do that we need to imitate. We need to love others. We need to tell others about Jesus. We need to obey our parents. Do y'all obey your parents? Yes, because it says so. We do make mistakes. You're right. We do make mistakes. Yes. And I think I said we love one another and we are to pray with joy. So all of those things, those are just a few things. God's word is filled with everything that we need to do and imitate so that we can be and walk in his love. Can we imitate God this week and do the things that are pleasing to him? All right. So as you go this week, remember that to be imitators of God. Let's say a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you that you love us. I thank you that you have given us your word so that we can be imitators of you and live a life worthy of you, Lord Jesus, and walk in your love and your grace and your truth, Lord. Just bless these boys and girls and their families, and just bless our time in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. I want to encourage you to go ahead and register your attendance through the app. I'm going to do that. Can I do that real quick? Just to show you guys that I will do anything that I request that anybody else does. So I got the app open. I'm going to check in. This is the late service. There's my family. There's my ugly mug. And so I'm going to choose 10:45. I'm checked in. Carlene is here too, right? I saw her. So I'm going to check her in. And we're done. As I said before, that kind of helps us to know who can't connect with us during certain seasons. So if you do that, that'd be awesome. Our Wednesday nights for the spring have concluded, and we will start back on the 19th of June, and that summer session will run for 6 weeks. The 24th, this Wednesday after next, is our youth fundraiser, the cake and pie auction, A barbecue meal will be served at 5:30. The auction will start at 6:30 with a professional auctioneer. That'll be a lot of fun. And Brent shared with me this morning that he would love to receive a bunch of homemade cakes and pies. Nothing out of a box, right, Brent?
Yes.
That rules me out, sorry. And if you can supply one of those, just contact the church office and let us know that that's taking place. And all donations will assist youth that are going to summer camps and the mission trip for this summer as well. If you're new to our fellowship and want to know more about our church, you can meet with our pastor on the 28th of this month. That's 2 weeks from today. And for a discovery class, that'll take place at 9 a.m. in the church office. And then Senior Sunday is May the 5th, and we will honor our graduating seniors. So let's stand, if you're able, and let's affirm our faith together. Hello, Ben. I told you guys I'm not much to look at. There we go. Thank you. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. I want to encourage you in your private prayer time to be in prayer for the nation of Israel. They've got some decisions to make in regards to the attack last night. And I'm just amazed that that attack was pretty much 100% repelled. And I know they've got great military weaponry there. But I wonder how much God had to do with that. I just wonder. So pray for them as they make decisions about how to respond to that and just for protection for that nation in general. Pray that our leadership of our country will stand firm in support of the nation of Israel. So this morning, I want to give everybody an opportunity to have their needs prayed for. If you have something going on in your life and you would like people to pray for you, with you about that, it could be a health issue, could be a financial issue, just a family issue, or just life in general. It's overwhelming sometimes for some of us. And so if you would like prayer this morning, I just want to invite you to stand, and we'd love to surround you and pray over you. You don't have to say anything, but if you'd like to share that need with the people around you, then you have the freedom to do that as well. So if you need prayer this morning, I'm just going to invite you to stand. Or stand in the place of somebody that might need prayer this morning. Anybody else? I tell you, let's surround these two ladies. And as they pray, church, I'm going to encourage you to pray as well. Or if you have something in your circle that's going on, just lift that up to the Lord this morning. If y'all want to share what's going on, you feel the freedom to do that with the people that surrounded you. And after they've had a chance to pray, then I'll close this. Father, we thank you for your presence. Just so sweet. Holy Spirit, would you just minister to our hearts this morning? Things that we truly, truly need. pray blessings on these two that have stood. And Father, I just agree with what's been prayed. Lord, for others of us that chose not to stand, I pray that you move in power in those needs and bring about things that brings glory to the Father. Oh Lord, we praise you. We adore you. And we magnify your holy name. Jesus, thank you for being so good to us. Thank you for your work on the cross. We pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray. Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. I want to remind you, we'll have several available for prayer after the service. If you need prayer, I encourage you to take advantage of that. Our giving options are on the screen. We have offering boxes by the doors. If you have a prayer need, you want to drop a prayer request card in the offering box as well. We'd love to pray for that need. Church, thank you so much for your faithfulness.
Good.
You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
You are good, you're good.
Church, you are good, you're good.
Well, good morning again. I want to make an announcement that most of you, or some of you know, and some of you don't. Our very own Shauna Johnson is no longer Shauna Johnson as of yesterday. She is now Shauna Wylie. Her and Cody Wylie were married last night. And so be prayerful for them. Great couple. We're excited about that. If you are guests this morning, we're really glad you're here. We're really glad you're here. We love guests. We hope that you feel the love of Christ in this place and the love of His people and His Holy Spirit, and hope that you will feel led to be more than guests in the future. But if today we have a card in the seat pocket in front of you that says guest registration with a blue stripe, and would love for you to fill that out. I'd love to meet you after the service. I'll be down at this end of the foyer, have a free gift. There might even be a little bit of coffee and donuts down there. It's left at the end of the service. Maybe. Sometimes there is and sometimes there isn't. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is where we are today. And that chapter is known as? The love. I told the early service, you got to say it with attitude. The love chapter. Okay, maybe not. 1 Corinthians 13. Now, as I read through several verses of this chapter, I want you to listen for feelings. And this would be my cue to launch into feelings, nothing, but I'm not going to do that. I want you to watch for feelings, emotion in what we read. And y'all let me know later what you found, what you heard. Verse 1. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Man, don't you hate it when God's word meddles in our life? Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Verse 13. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Let's pray. Father, we're humbled that you love us. Would you send your Holy Spirit? Would you teach us how to love like you? Speak, Holy Spirit, in power and authority and transform our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. So, continuing the sermon series, what if? What if? Today's message is, what if I loved sacrificially? Read you a little quick little paragraph here. In 1997, Glenn Scotty, we went by Scotty, Glenn Scotty Wolf, this gentleman right there, he died alone in Los Angeles at the age of 88. No one came to claim his body. The city paid to have him buried in an unmarked grave. The Guinness Book of World Records listed him as the most married man in the world with 31 marriages to his credit. Now, go ahead. I've actually listed out his marriages. He couldn't get them all on one screen, so there's the first 15. And there's the next 16. So that means that 31 times Scotty Wolf was asked, do you take this woman to be your lawfully wedded wife, forsaking all others? Do you pledge yourself only to her as long as you both shall live? Now, I said something similar to Shauna and Cody yesterday. 31 times Glenn Wolf said, I do. But it never quite worked out that way. In fairness to Wolf, 4 of those 31 times his wife predeceased him. The last of his 31 wives was a woman named Linda Taylor, most married woman at 23 times. They married as a publicity stunt, and after a week of marriage, they parted and they never saw each other again. Mr. Wolf died leaving behind 19 children, 40 grandchildren, 19 great-grandchildren, a number of living ex-wives, and innumerable ex-in-laws. Can you imagine keeping up with those ex-wives and ex-in-laws? He spent his entire adult life looking for something that he apparently never found, and he died alone. Not any of these ex-wives came to his funeral. An even sadder note about Mr. Wolf, he was a preacher. Is this on? Yes, indeed. Look it up. Do you think that as we speak about loving sacrificially, do you think that he spent his life loving sacrificially or loving self-centeredly? I didn't know the man, obviously. But something about this history speaks about how he lived his life. So let's talk about living sacrificially. What if I lived sacrificially? First thing I want us to look at is that God is the source of sacrificial love. It's not helpful. He's not just helpful. He's the very source of sacrificial love. We, in and of ourselves, in our flesh, we don't have the ability to live sacrificially, to love sacrificially. I've said this before, we come out of the womb a self-centered person. I'm hungry, I'm wet, I'm sleepy. You don't have to work at it. We don't have to work at being self-centered. We don't have to practice. We don't have to be trained. It's instinctive in us. It's who we are. But God would have us to not be self-centered, but to be sacrificial in the way that we love. And that God is the very source of that sacrificial love. 1 John 4, dear friends, let us love one another, for love, here it is, comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Now, this is where it's meddling again. It's hard. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. I've said this so many times. I know you get tired of hearing some of these things, but I call them freeze-dried Christians. Angry, freeze-dried Christians are not attractive. Did you know that? If you are an angry person, God needs to do some work in your heart. Because that doesn't mean that we never get angry, but if we walk around and it's like we're just got this scowl on our face, and yet we proclaim Christ as our Lord and Savior, I'm telling you, there's nobody going to be attracted to that. Those who do not love do not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. And then he goes on to say, dear friends, since God so loved us, we ought to love one another. So he has given us the model, and he is the source. Second point, sacrificial love is active and intentional. I quote this sometimes. Stephen Covey, many of you have read Seven Habits for Highly Effective People, Stephen was not a Christian. He was a Mormon, but he's deceased now. But truth is truth, wherever truth comes from. And here's what one of the things that he said is that love is a verb. There's action. It's not just feeling. It's not warm and fuzzy. It is action. It is doing. Listen, and I asked you when we started this reading the passage out of 1 Corinthians 13, but listen to a few of these verses again, and listen for the feelings where he's talking about how we feel. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It's not proud. It's not rude. It's not self-seeking. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, trusts, hopes, perseveres. Love never fails. Do you hear any feeling in there? There is no feeling. Love is a verb. Love is active and intentional. And what's probably the most well-known common scripture that there is? John 3:16. You remember I was telling the early service, I don't know why, just kind of showing my age. You remember the Afro guy? The rainbow Afro guy at the ball games? And he would have his shirt that said John 3:16, white shirt with blue trim, and he had the rainbow Afro wig, and he'd always position himself behind the goalpost or somewhere where he knew the camera was going to be zooming. Afro guy. So, he was odd. He was an odd dude. I don't know anything about him, but he got something right. He was trying to tell the world, God loves you. And he doesn't just say that, but God has proven it. That passage, for God so loved, his motive is love. For God so loved that he gave Jesus, his one and only Son, so that we might not perish, but have eternal life when we place our faith in him. Jesus said in John 15, my commandment is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than he lay down his life for his friends. And really, as we think about God's sacrificial love being active and intentional, Romans 5, you see at just the right time, Paul tells us, when we were still powerless, anybody else relating to when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. He didn't die for the best of us. He died for the worst of us. He died for sinners. It goes on to say, very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But here it is. God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So sacrificial love, the sacrificial love of Christ, it's not about feeling. As I was walking Shauna and Cody through their vows, they stated their own vows, but through their declaration of intention, what they intended to do that day, there was, and I reminded them that it was nothing about, even though they felt very much in love in that moment and will so often, sacrificial love is not about this warm, fuzzy feeling. It's about sacrifice. I said it, I think, last week or the week before, that the most loving act in all of human history was a man being nailed to a cross. That's love. It was not a warm and fuzzy moment for our Savior. It was a sacrificial moment when He gave His life for us. Third point, and it leads us into sacrificial love, is a choice. In the choice, we get this wrong, I think, so many times in the church. We think that we choose God. And we say it. It's in our language. We say, I've accepted Christ. I want to be baptized. And so there's this, what we are doing. And I would just tell you that, guess what? God is the one that initiates the love. We choose to accept it or reject it, but God is the initiator. When we do baptism, I remind the ones that when we baptize, it's like, do you realize that this is not you just doing something? God is involved here. Did you know that? God is involved here. He is the one that initiated relationship with you. He has chosen to love us while we were yet sinners. Not that he doesn't love us at our best. He loves us at our very worst. Hebrews 12:2 mentioned this earlier a couple of weeks ago. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. So the joy set before him was what? You and I. Our salvation. Our being reconciled to the Father. That was the joy set before him. And so if God through Christ has chosen to love us, then you and I have a choice. He's saying, love the way I've loved you. I've demonstrated it to you. His admonition to us is to love like that. Fourth thing. As I said earlier, we can't do this in our own strength. Number four, the Holy Spirit empowers us to love sacrificially. Romans 5, God has poured out His love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. I encourage you, we talked about that, I believe last week, we talked about the fruit of the Spirit, but I encourage you to memorize Galatians 5, 22, the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Memorize those. That when we have Christ in us, when we have the Holy Spirit dwelling in us, the fruit of the Spirit should be oozing out of us, out of our ears, everywhere. It should be oozing out of us. It doesn't mean we can walk it out in perfection as our Lord did, but we should be full of the Spirit. And guess what? The very first Spirit, very first fruit listed, love. We should be a people that loves well. So I love, as I wrap up, I love the story of Peter. Y'all have heard me talk. Peter's my man because, and I hate to keep whipping out the Greek on you, but he was a knucklehead. It's Greek. You read it, sir. He was a knucklehead just like me. And I love that because, you know, Jesus he's washed the disciples' feet. First feet, Peter's like, you're not washing my feet. And he does. And then he says to Jesus, if everybody else denies you and betrays you and goes, you know, falls away, not me. And Jesus, I don't know. This isn't in the word, but I can just imagine Jesus just shaking his head and going, Peter, Peter, Peter. Yes. three times you will deny that you even know me before the rooster crows. And I can just, I don't know, I can just kind of put myself there. You know, they're leading Jesus to trial and got him bound up. And I can just imagine Peter and Jesus' eyes connecting when Peter says, I don't know the man. Can you see it? Can you be there? Their eyes connect, and I just imagine that Jesus must have had a look of disappointment, but yet deep love for Peter in that moment. Kind of like, I mean, I probably would have said, I told you so. Jesus didn't. They just probably connected eyes. And then Peter sees Jesus go to the cross. They see him crucified. And then 3 days later, this isn't in the word either, but this is my version of how it went. The women go to the tomb, it's empty. They come back and they tell the disciples, they tell Peter, the tomb's empty, he's risen, just like he said. And I it's not in the word, but I just feel like Peter went, uh-oh. don't you think? Oh man, I am in for a scolding. Because the last time our eyes connected, I was saying the words, I don't know the man. And yet, when Jesus encountered Peter and the rest of the disciples, he said, peace be with you. And I picture that moment. And then not long after that, Peter and the other disciples, they're out fishing, and they look on the shore, and Jesus is cooking them breakfast. And y'all, I've played this before, but I picture the scene from Forrest Gump. When Forrest sees Lieutenant Dan on the dock, and he's like, that's my impersonation of Forrest Gump. And can't you see Peter going, and he gets so excited like Forrest did. And he's like, man, I don't know if they're even going to get the boat short. And he just dives in because he's so excited. Because this Savior who died for him, this Savior who he denied, this Savior who should have scolded him, met him with love and grace. Peace be with you. And he meets you and I in the same way. No matter what we've done, no matter what has been done to us, no matter what shame or guilt or whatever anger that we're dragging around with us, Jesus would say to us, peace be with you. Come on, I'm frying up some fish here. Let's have breakfast. And then he asked, we know the story. Jesus asked Peter three times, do you love me? And the second time, Peter gets a little annoyed. He's like, Lord, you know my heart, you know my mind, you know I love you. Why do you keep asking me? And each time, Jesus says, feed my sheep. So it stuck out to me a few years ago that Jesus doesn't say, do you love my sheep? Is this on? He doesn't say, do you love my sheep? Guess what? Sheep can bite. You ever had a sheep bite you? And I'm talking about people. You may have had a real sheep bite you too, but if you have, come tell me. I want to hear the story. But sheep can bite. But Jesus says, do you love me? Then feed my sheep. Demonstrate you love me by loving people. Sacrificially. And it's not... And guess what? It's not that we should love just when people love us back and build us up. And it's like, man, again, Jesus washed Judas's feet. He forgave the disciples that denied him and deserted him. Do you love me? Jesus says, feed my sheep. Invite the praise team to come back up. If you'll just bow your heads with me. Jesus, we don't know how in our own strength to love like you love. We confess that. We want to invite your spirit to well up in us, well up to magnify, multiply your fruit in us. As we talked about, may your love ooze out of us. Even when people don't like us, even when people say bad things about us, help us love the way you love. Help us forgive the way you forgive. And we can't love as you love unless we understand how you love us. So if there's any this morning, Lord, that don't understand how you love them, would you convey that to their hearts through your Holy Spirit right now? In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. As we rise to close, if you are able, we've got the altar rail is open. If you don't know that Jesus and the love that he has for you this morning, please don't leave this place today without talking to me about that.
You gave your life for mine. Cross, you crucified all my sin and shame. It was washed by your mercy. You are the treasure I find, my reason for living. So let my life become for you.
Would ask you the same thing he asked Peter. Do you love him?
Yes.
That was about as weak as we can get. Shall we try that one more time? Do you love him?
Yes.
Go and feed his sheep, church. Go and tell someone we're dismissed. God bless you. Hi, this is Pastor Jeff Hatcher with Wylie Methodist Church in Abilene, Texas. I want to thank you for listening to this message from God's Word today. If you do not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, He loves you and He wants to be your friend and your Savior. If that is you, I ask you to pray this prayer with me. Lord, I confess that I am a sinner. I ask you to forgive me of my sin. I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and my Savior and wash me as white as snow in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer today for the first time, I invite you to do four things. First of all, tell someone, share this decision with someone. We are better together than we are alone. And then also, I ask you to consider being baptized. Jesus himself set the example for us by being baptized himself, and he encourages us to do the same. And then I ask you to consider finding a Bible-believing and Bible-preaching church and plug in. Again, we are better together than alone. And then finally, I ask you to get into God's Word. It's not just because it is makes us a better person, but also because it is the living Word, and God speaks to us through His Word. The Gospel of John is a great place to begin. If I can help you be of any sort of assistance through this process, you can contact me at my email address, jhatcher@wylymethodist.org. God bless you.